All right, we'll continue with part three, where we're looking at sources for vertical shear. Here we'll focus on a conceptual model of jet streaks and how they influence the deep layer wind profiles as air moves through the jet streak. So again, it should be somewhat obvious that you will get some increase in deep layer vertical wind shear with the approach of a jet streak. By definition, it's a core of stronger winds approaching, so of course you would think that the winds would increase with height as this occurs. But the processes that are related to vertical motion with the jet streak also are associated with changes in mass and momentum flux. It changes the wind profile as well. So it's the agiostrophic response. So if we put this in quasi-geostrophic terms, it's the part of the wind that we don't let do any advecting, but it's the response to the geostrophic portion of the advections, which is a simplification of what's happening on the large scale. And so what we'll do is we'll show an example of the straight jet streak model, where you refer to the, you've got entrance and exit regions of the jet, which should sound familiar. First thing you need to keep in mind is that the air moves through the jet streak. The jet streak itself is moving slower than the flow that's going through it, so you have to consider what's happening to the air that's encountering the jet streak, what's occurring as it moves through that, because other properties are changing at the same time. So the air entering the jet streak, it's actually encountering an area with stronger gradients, which is what drives the stronger flow. The stronger gradients are also related not just of the heights or pressure, depending on how you want to look at it, but there's also stronger thermal gradients. Air moving into the stronger thermal gradient, that's actually frontogenetic. Well, there's a response to that, and this is what we call the direct thermal circulation in the entrance region, which I've highlighted here. This would be like a sloped isentropic surface, but the point is the jet, and this would be looking in, here you're looking into the page, the air that's coming into the jet streak, the response to frontogenesis is to weaken the gradient in the atmosphere, so there tends to be ascent, or in this case, it's ascent on the warm side, which ascent will result in adiabatic cooling, and then on the cold side, there's descent, which is adiabatic warming. So we're trying to reduce the temperature gradient as the response to the atmosphere. So that's what the direct thermal circulation and the entrance region of the jet. Air leaving is moving out the exit region. It's the opposite. It's frontolytic. So the thermal, it's moving into a weakening thermal gradient. Whereas again, the atmosphere doesn't like those changes. So it's trying to result in sinking on the warm side, which is adiabatic warming, and rising motion on the cool side, which is adiabatic cooling, which tries to strengthen the gradient. So what happens is you end up with vertical motion or ascent in the right entrance region over here, or the right rear quadrant of the jet, and ascent in the left exit region for the conceptual model for a purely straight jet streak. Okay, so the air moves through the jet streak. Again, I just went through all this just to reiterate, it encounters stronger temperature gradient when it enters and a weaker temperature gradient when it exits. So the point here is that we can actually look at this in terms of frontogenesis, what's happening as air moves through the jet streak, the response to that. Now, how you get that response, there's also a change in the wind profiles, because if we have ascent going on in the left exit region, for example, that means there has to be differential divergence through mass continuity. So there's divergence increasing with height. Well, you have to be replacing that mass from somewhere. You're replacing it in the low levels from the anticyclonic side of the jet, or from the right exit region. So I'll illustrate that. And then if you have sufficient moisture and buoyancy, you can actually create a nice severe storm environment through this process. Okay, so now what we're doing is we're looking at like a plan view of the jet streak from above. So you're just looking down, in this case, like if a map, north typically would be up here, south is down here. So we're just looking at it from above. This is just a plot of ice attacks. So we've got some sort of speed max, and then I've just highlighted the left exit and right entrance regions of the jet. There are responses in the aloft, in yellow, that's the agiostrophic response, which if the air aloft, the agiostrophic response is in this direction, it creates divergence here, convergence here, so the divergence aloft is related to the vertical motion, the ascent you're seeing from below that. And the same thing happens in the opposite quadrant, the right entrance. So in the low levels, the response is the opposite to replace that mass. So if you start to think about this, you go, wait a minute, in this, especially this left exit region, I've got westerly flow aloft with the way I've drawn this, but I'm inducing an agiostrophic southerly wind, which now I've got a change in the wind with height, so I'm actually creating stronger vertical shear in response to the mass adjustments with the jet stream. And so, and that also coincides with rising motion, potentially a source for storm initiation, and then sinking. Now again, this is the pure conceptual model. There are not very many jet streaks that look exactly like this in the real world. Okay, now we've taken a completely different view of this. We're looking at the exit region response. So just to show what this would be is just to continue through. This is the air parcels move through. We get the agiostrophic response, and in the low levels you induce stronger low-level southerly flow. So we've got a veering wind with height is what we've created in that exit region. Okay, now switch your frame of reference. We've now turned and we're looking west into the jet stream. So the air's coming at you out of the screen. This is what the thermally indirect transverse circulation looks like in the exit region. And I've highlighted the left exit region, so this would be aloft. So in the upper part, aloft, and on the downstream part of the jet stream, this is what the mass response looks like. So we've got vertical motion, rising motion, it's replacing this with low-level flow from the south, because remember, we're looking west, and there's divergence aloft and mass response. So you get this circulation around the jet streak, and this is in the exit region. The same kind of thing is going on in the entrance region. It's just literally a reversed mirror image of it. Okay, with a curved jet, without going into all the complicated details, the divergence aloft and ascent also extend into the core of the jet streak with the cyclonic curvature. So it's not as simple as just saying the exit region. You can actually have divergence and the mass response along the core of the jet. And that right exit region, or the right front quadrant, is not nearly as hostile to storm development with a curved jet streak as it would be from the presumed sinking air and the subsidence regime that you would see with a straight jet streak. And then you still have the agiostrophic response, but it's skewed toward the warm side. So the idea here is don't get too hung up if you're trying to forecast severe storm and say, oh, well, this is the right exit region of this curved jet. There can't be severe storms. There's an awful lot of outbreaks that occur in that area because everything else is favorable there. So again, it's not just the deep layer vertical response that matters. You have to consider the entire profile. So just summarize that, again, you get the most favorable profiles for supercells through this mass adjustment will be in the left exit region. But thermodynamically, if you consider just geography, a typical jet streak from moving from west to east to the anticyclonic side of the jet is also closer to the moisture source. You've had longer with moisture advection. Oftentimes, it's the right entrance region that is the most unstable thermodynamically. So you don't have the same mass response, but you actually have a better thermodynamic profile for storms often. So the left exit region, the question is, can we generate the buoyancy to support severe storms?